I shall get in this picture too.
Yeah, come on over. Come on over.
That'd be great.
Yeah.
Three generations.
Oh, that's pretty heavy. We should have one.
Oh, hold on. I don't want to get us dirty with the onion. Well, I'm the fifth generation now?
Say your name.
Fifth generation Brandon. And this is my father, and this is my grandfather. He's been growing the flowers. Well, for the last couple of years, you haven't been. And then he does all the hard work, like the plants and all the... And I do the harvesting. That's basically what we do every year.
I'm Kenneth Bigham, and we are here in Table Rock at the Bighams Nursery. And this place here belongs to my cousin, Wayne Smith. And he's lived here all his entire life in this one place. My grandfather moved to Sam's Valley in 1909. They lived he came here in 1883 or 4, and they lived on Vilas Road, and it was his stepbrother, which brought him out here to live with him. And then they lived right across the road there on Vilas Road. The Berries lived there.
Do you remember the address?
No.
Okay. Who was your grandfather?
Grandfather was John Bigham, and my grandmother was Aletta Bell Berry Bigham.
And the stepbrother?
It was Bigham.
William.
William Bigham, yes.
Okay.
They lived at, they lived a lot of places. Because my grandfather lived right across the road from the Berries, and the Berries was where my grandmother, she was a very young woman and he was a very young man. And first time he saw my grandmother over there, she's swinging in a swing out of the tree, you know. And so he says, I'm gonna marry that lady someday. And it wasn't too many years, a couple years after that, they were married. And then from there, they went down to Sebastopol, California, because her folks were there. And her father got killed, and so they went down there. And they were down there for a couple weeks. And they had a little baby girl before they went. And Mary Myers. And she was the oldest one of the family. And then from there, they moved down there, and they stayed there for 2 years. Down at Sebastopol before they came back here. And then Bill or William Bigham was born down there in California. And then they came back to it, and they had a place where the Fred Meyer's store stands today. That was their property there. And they had gardens and everything like that there.
Out on Crater Lake?
Out on the other end of the northern, the southern part.
Oh,
of
the southern part.
Yeah,
okay.
Southern part. And then they went from there.
What did they grow? Do you remember? And why did they choose agriculture?
Well, most of the old timers, that's what they did. If they were farmers, they just agriculture. Everything, they raised everything because they raised all of it to eat. And so then what they had left over, they sold. I mean, they had chickens, they had eggs, so to sell. And so then from that, where there's that there, they moved to...
Was that rented property or...
That was rented from those days. And then they rented a place up on the, what's the mountain? Roxanne. Behind Roxanne, east of on the rock side, they had a lot of farms and things up there. And so they farmed up there for about maybe three to 6 years. And then that's where my father was born in 1900 up there. And I had never been up there all my life, and I don't know if my dad ever knew where he came from or not at that time. And those days they didn't travel back and forth like they do today, you know. And my grandfather had to have a buggy and horse to bring all the produce down. He brought eggs, and when they lived up there behind the mountain, they had 40 some different kinds of apples. And so I'm sure they must have sold apples. And it's just a beautiful place up in there, and I always thought it was probably terrible looking, but I really was proud of it when I went up there to see all the stuff, the farmland back up there behind the mountain. So then in 1903, they moved down to off of Vilas, clear at the other end, the Phoenix Road. And they lived there for several years. And then they moved to Eagle Point on the Owens place. And then later on they went, and some of the kids, I have it in the document, that where they was born, when they was born, and when they was born. Because when children were born in those days, they didn't know where babies came from. And so they'd see some doctor come in with a satchel, and then he'd leave, and then he'd come out and say, "You got a little baby brother." So they thought he brought that baby brother in the satchel. So this went on, that when my dad was about, he's in the middle one. And then they moved from there to, what's that creek in Eagle Point? Butte Creek. Not too far from Butteville Falls, Butte Creek, place that burnt down. Anyway, and so they had a farm, a garden on one side of the creek, and they lived on the other side, but the other side was higher than the other side. And to get to see if their property was able to start planting or working up, they'd have to forge the creek, take their horses and go across the creek to see about it. And that's, they grew produce there too, so every place they went, they were farming. And then after that, in 1909, they moved to Sam's Valley and bought the property in Sam's Valley. And we had about, I don't know, over 400 acres at one time. And then my grandfather, he planted watermelons and sold a lot of watermelons, because the road that went right in front of our house was the main road going to Crater Lake. So all the traffic from Gold Hill traveled that road, and they'd stop and get watermelons and different kind of melons we had and whatever was available at that time. And so, and in those days, we didn't have irrigation there, but we had thunderstorms and lightning storms about every week anyway, so I can see why the melons and everything done well on dry land, because they had enough water to survive, you know. And he used to have the beautiful watermelons, beautiful.
What else did he grow up there?
Well, we had chickens, we had turkeys, we had pigs, we had beef cattle.
I've seen record of alfalfa.
Alfalfa, yes. He grew four crops of beautiful alfalfa. And then the war came in 1941.
Dairy?
Pardon?
Dairy cows?
Yes, dairy cows.
How
yeah.
many? A lot? Or?
Oh, he didn't have too many. He had more of the stock cattle.
Uh-huh.
Because he drove them to Diamond Lake, up near Diamond Lake. He had a place for the summer range. And he'd drive them up there with horses, and the cattle were walking on the, down the road. And we never lost one cow with anyone hitting. Nowadays, not safe at all. We truck them nowadays and still can't get them there.
It's cold at night.
Yeah, we have two greenhouses that are heated here, and then the other greenhouses are not. So that's why we move stuff so much.
Well, this time of year, cook by day and freeze by night, so.
I think the most helpful for us children was to be in 4-H. And in FFA, when I went to Crater High School. That changed my life right there. if it wasn't for the Future Farmers of America, I wouldn't be where I'm at today. And we had such a good teacher, Mr. Kunzman, and he's still alive in Salem, Oregon, way up there in the years, but he was the nicest person you'd ever meet. Like I said, I owe a lot to him.
What did you learn?
Well, we learned how we should treat each other and how we was able to work on the soil, how we could raise animals. You know, they had classes on chickens and on pigs and all kinds of things. You learned about those, you know, but being from the farm, you already knew most of it anyway, you know. It's just a review, but it was a good review.
Did it bring you in contact with other children, other people? That
yes,
were,
right.
So it created a community for you.
Yes, and then every year so many, we got to go to Kansas City, Missouri to a convention, and I was one of them the first, second, third years there I went up there. And it was just wonderful to see the thousands of people there, you know. It's all the same farmers, you know. In those days, we didn't have women, no girls. I mean, I'm not against girls and women today, but I mean, nowadays, they can do the work that a man can do too, you know. So, but it was wonderful.
Now, what about 4-H?
4-H was wonderful. It was more for, you know, I had the first 1945, I had grand champion, the first grand champion lamb at the county fair. That was the first fair they had there with sheep. And I had a south down, and they're the littlest thing you've ever seen. And nowadays, you get the tall sheep, you know, they want big sheep, you know. I don't know how I ever got grand champion on the little thing. I still don't know. But anyway, you learn a lot at 4-H, how to handle animals and things. Wayne and I both was in 4-H and did these things together. He had a dairy animals and I had dairy animals and beef and pigs and sheep and I don't know what else. We didn't have no chickens. Then we had plenty of chickens at home. We did take them, but it was a lot of fun when everybody was working together. It was just one big family, you know. No matter what you had, you didn't have anything, it didn't look good, it still was good, you know what I mean? And we didn't condemn one person over the other, you know, it was all in the same on key, you know?
Now I've got this article here about 74 years of 4-H service is notable achievement of local Bigham family.
That's right.
13 family members honored for leadership.
That's right.
Yeah.
I have a picture of all of them.
Yeah.
They took it at the fairgrounds of us all there that was there.
Yeah.
But it was for, I had my uncle, Bill Bigham, was one of the head ones there. But I guess the first one that had the 4-H was my grandmother. She had a sewing club in Sam's Valley. And then I had an uncle, my uncles, both of these uncles, Bill and Albert, lived in Eagle Point. And the Brown Bigham Roads named after them. And then I had another, well then our aunt, she was the only girl of the family that was there then, because she was in 4-H a lot, you know, one of the head people. And then I had my dad, Earl Bigham. And so I think there's four of them one there. But a lot of the kids, all the kids, grandkids and stuff were 4-H leaders and everything in their years. So we had a lot of family.
Is the hall still Bigham Hall?
No, it was used to be where Fred Myers is, where it was at. And when they did that, they didn't change the name. They just have a memorial of Bill Bigham at the fairgrounds now, or at the expo. Well, I was born here, and it was just home. I lived there for just 70-some years, just about. And it was hard to leave, because I was kicked off of the place twice. During the wartime, we had to leave because the government came and devaluated our property, so they didn't have to pay us much money. And then we had to move off in July, but the government didn't pay us any money. And there's a lot of homes out back in there, you know. Well, no one, there must a lot of them are older people.
What year was that?
That was 1941.
Why did they make you move out on 1941?
Cantonment land. They were going to use that for military. They had the pillboxes up there. You've probably heard about the pillboxes.
Yeah.
Well, that ours was, our place was right at the beginning line where they take it, would take the place all the way east. Well, we got the place back in 1948.
Did you have to buy it back?
Yes. But when we bought it back, we had no houses, no wells, no fencing, no gates. What else didn't we have? We didn't have anything, hardly.
Why? They took them all out?
Yeah. Well, they destroyed them. My grandmother had a nice house there, and it was the beginning of the property where they started. And they kept her house for their help.
Is that house still there?
No. We don't know what it, when what. We used to go up to see if it was there, but sometimes something happened to it. So I don't know if they burned it up. And we sold our house. We had a smaller house from my grandmother's, and we got to sell it. But they wouldn't let us sell my grandmother's because they wanted to keep it. I don't think they give very much. I know what they give them. I got it all on paper, how much they give and everything, you know. It's just unbelievable how they got away with it. And then so when we came back, we had to buy it. And well, just for that, from when we left here, we had no place to go. And you had nothing. You had to get rid of everything because you couldn't take it. Well, I had a grandfather who lived in Grants Pass and had the money that he helped us buy my folks buy a place down there in New Hope. And that's where we lived for 2 years. Then from there we went to Ashland, 6 years. Then we came back out here, moved back here in Sam's Valley in 1950. And we were the first ones that moved back up in there.
And was that the same property?
Yeah, the same property.
Same property.
But we had to refence it. We had to do all the fencing.
Do you remember what you paid for that? What
year? Back? I think we paid $1 an acre.
And how many acres did you pick up at that time?
Oh, we had about 300 acres then.
Okay. Was that about the size of the original property?
Yeah. My dad, every post, we had put a wooden post in, and he sharpened every one with an axe to make a point to drive them down. And then we got up in, on a little box, and he had a mall, and he just hammered the post down.
That's rocky.
And he did that all himself.
Yeah.
Constantly.
Yeah.
Never complained one time. But that's the reason he left Ashland, because he wanted to come back home. This is home to him. You know, we had a beautiful place in Ashland, but he wanted to come out here. So that's the reason we're here. And then so from then, my grandfather died in 1928 and left my grandmother there with her three children. And they weren't old, they were young. I mean, they weren't old, young, they were in their 30s before they were left home. I just worked there. My dad didn't get married till he was 34 years old, and he worked on the farm after his dad died and took care of the farm.
So in 1950, you had to rebuild everything.
Had to build new houses. We had to build barns. We had to build, I think we first built our barn in 1948. And then we didn't build a house till 1950 because we didn't have possession exactly. They sure wrecked our land. And then we had shells out in the fields. So the first time we went through, it was very dangerous. Sometimes we had to call the person that come out and find them for us. And you know, you're out there disting and you never know when you're going to hit one and blow up. But I don't, to my knowledge, no one got hurt in any place, but they did find them. Dad sold several acres off of it. I don't know how many, but then he should have divided it all at that time, because then it came the law that they couldn't divide the place anymore. And when you have a place that could raise four crops of alfalfa, and then they got down to where they can hardly raise one. So you know, they sure wrecked our land. Well, we got lawyers and everything trying to help us, but not a one of them was any good. All we did was pay them money for nothing. Some of them got what they wanted. and then they're through with us.
So what year did the land, what did, when did you kind of want to
subdivide it?
Subdivide it, or?
Oh, I don't know, maybe around 2000, between 2004 and 8. And, but the law was that you couldn't divide your place because it was exclusively farmland, but you couldn't grow anything on it anymore. And some of these big shots would come out and try to grow anything, they couldn't have grown it either. They know what we're talking about, but they don't care. They didn't care. You know, it's sort of sad to think that they kicked us off originally, and then this time, in this area, well, we tried to divide it, and we couldn't get it divided, and finally we just had to, we lost it, my son and I lost the price. We walked off of there with not one penny. That's sad. You know? And then from there, after we got all that done, and then we wanted to move. We finally sold my place that I had originally, and we moved down on the home place. And that's when we had a lot of help financially, supposed to be, but when they wouldn't, there were a bunch of doctors here in this wonderful city of Medford, Oregon, that loaned us the money through a loaning company. And we couldn't pay what they wanted, over $3,000 a month. And with my son and I both, we still couldn't afford it because we wouldn't have anything left to get machinery, anything else if something happens. You know, you're paying them. So we just said, there it is, it's yours. And from there on, well, we had greenhouses on the place. And then we moved the greenhouses. I have cousins down here where I'm at right now, on Glenna's and Wayne's, and we've been down here on this farm. I always feel at home here because this is where I was always dumped off when we went. My folks went to town because I had Wayne and his sister and his brother, and they liked us to come down because, see, we were young and they were older, so they used us like toys. Uh-oh, he's not saying anything. Maybe he don't remember it. Yeah. We're on Pumice Lane, on off of, what's the road out here?
Table Rock Road,
yeah. I forgot where it's at. Table Rock Road and Pumice Lane. Wayne lives right at the corner there. And he's been here all his life, like I said. And so he retired from working and everything. He worked out in the orchards and things. And then when we had to move, well, Wayne told Doug to come down here and farm his place. And then I have another cousin farms back here, and so she wanted him to farm hers. And so that's how we got down to Table Rock. So, and Wayne's been so nice to him to let him do that for him. So Wayne's always liked this kind of stuff anyway. So he's a farmer. Planter. I remember seeing him when he was a young kid out here in the thing, picking beans, but his grandmother's right next to him, so she kept him working. He don't know I have a picture of that. Right, Wayne?
Right.
Yes.
I work in the orchard down here. Before I retired. And this was my closest place. And when they all passed away, I was living on it, so I just stayed there on it. Leela and Fred Smith.
And Leela was a Bigham, his mother.
I'm Doug Bigham.
what, fifth generation, I guess, Bigham farm, or no, fourth generation, I'm sorry, my son's fifth generation.
And you farm this land here?
And I farm, yeah, some of Wayne's property and another cousin's piece that joins this property too, so.
About how many acres?
About 12 acres altogether that we're farming right now.
Would you like to farm more?
No.
Tell me about that.
I mean, 12 acres is enough to do for, you know, just a few of us. I mean, if you get the more bigger you get, the more people you got to hire, and you're really not making any more money, you're just spending a lot more time working. So,
what are you growing?
Mostly all vegetables, plants like tomatoes and spinach, and you know, vegetable crops. And only fruit we do would be melons. We don't do any kind of tree fruit or anything like that. So.
Melons are good around here.
Oh yeah, melons do well out here. Yeah.
Where do you sell your products?
We sell our product at the growers markets in Ashland, in Medford, and Grants Pass. And then we have a self-service stand here at the farm. And we also sell to some of the local store up the road here, Rainey's Market. Some of the other farm stands also buy our stuff and we sell it to them too.
So like Seven Oaks.
Like Seven Oaks, right.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
We don't really have a problem of finding a place to sell it. I mean, it's just a matter of growing enough, you know, what we can keep up with. So, and last year we even sold some to Brookings, a gal from Brookings come over. And some years we have extra product, and last year we were a little short on product for them, but when we have enough, uh-huh. Yeah.
And is it hard to sell at market?
The hardest part, you know, is getting ready and setting up and breaking down. And I've been doing it for 25 years, and I've probably done over 3,000 markets. So I've done many more markets than anybody in the valley. I'm not bragging, just the facts. I mean, when we started, there were just a few of us. The markets have changed a lot in 25 years since I've been doing it. On both ends, the size of the market's bigger, and also the clientele is a lot bigger than it used to be. When I first started doing it, people kind of looked at us as more of a swap meet than farmers markets, because farmers markets are fairly new. And now you see them on movies and everything else. Everybody knows what a farmers market is nowadays. So, yeah, so things have changed just in a few years. People that come year after year, especially with the bedding plants, you know, people kind of all see the same customers year after year come get their bedding plants in the spring. And same with produce people, you know. I sell to a lot of people that buy pickling cucumbers, and they're, you know, every year they call me up about the same time of year and said, are the cucumbers ready to, you know, make pickles? And beans are the same way. We sell a lot of green beans. A lot of people can beans and stuff like that. So, yeah.
Why are you doing this stuff?
Well, I mean, I enjoy it. I mean, really. Even though it is a lot of work, I enjoy the growing part of it, and I also enjoy the selling part of it. I like to see where the whole product ends, you know, from start to end. And we start the seeds here and grow the product, and then we sell it at the retail location. So.
Years back, and it was okay. It wasn't really anything serious, and then we really started to get lots of money by opening, like putting lots of signs out by the road, and people really knew what we had, like tomatoes and squash and stuff like that, and they were like, oh, you have squash and stuff. And so they started pulling in, and they really loved this self-service thing that we had out here. We have a self-service stand, and people just, they come by and they're like, oh, a self-service, man.
I am 19 now. I'm gonna be 20 this year, and then basically, I've just been helping him the last couple of years. I've been helping him all my life, basically, doing the markets and stuff and helping him out here. And last couple of years, I finally talked him into getting this farm stand open for us so we can actually make more money and stuff. And it's doing well so far, yeah. But he's getting old on me, so is him, so I'm helping him out the best I can.
That is a compliment, wasn't it?
Yeah, well, it is.
Yeah, we're giving you more responsibility.
Yeah.
Yeah, you got to take over for us.
Yep.
While you're still around.
Yeah.
So, do you think that you're going to continue branding?
Probably not. He was more of the farmer ever since then. When I like helping him and doing stuff like that, but I'd rather go into something more of like marketing or web designing, something where it's like, I'm good with money and people, so
yeah.
That's what I want to go into. And doing a lot of the markets and stuff like that, it really helps me learn how to deal with people and all the marketing stuff like that.
So do you think you'll stay with marketing and agriculture?
I think something along those lines, yeah.
I have to say, you need a website. That Webly thing is not there yet.
We have a Facebook page. Yeah. I just don't have a website yet. But yeah, I take all the photos and all that. I put all the information on there about what we have during the spring and what we were gonna have at the market the day before we have it there. Because I'm out here harvesting that night and I come home posted and yeah. So I've kind of updated him over the years. He was old fashioned there for a while, writing everything down, and we got him onto the computer and got him one of these smartphones where he can actually read the weather and get all that. And
yeah, I can read the stuff. I'm not too good at posting, but I can.
He's getting the hang of it.
I can get the information off.
That one, there's no hope for that one over there. Over the last, I think, two, three years, I've been helping my dad learn more about the future and how technology can help him with the weather and maintaining the frost. And this year, we've recently bought a grow light, which actually makes the plants grow and get greener due to the not very much daylight in the springtime, and then over the summer we'll move it out of there so it's safe. But for frost and stuff like that, it's really easy because he used to have to call my mom. She would have to look at the TV to see what the weather was to get if it was going to freeze tonight or not, and now he can just look at his smartphone and it can tell him everything from it's going to freeze tonight till next Friday it's going to freeze. So it's really nice for him to know that. And to, I mean, he still uses the sky and know if it's going to absolutely freeze or not, but it's still nice to know. Well, it's better to know that it's going to freeze than it is not to just randomly guess. Like, sometimes you can know or not if it's going to freeze or not freeze or something like that, but...
So that's really changed the technology
The technology has really helped.
And how you've kind of set up the greenhouses?
Yeah, we have the heat pads. He's had the heat pads for, I think, when he first started doing this, he's had the heat pads, and they kick on with the thermostat at night, so the plants will grow, the heat will go up from the table into the seeds, and the seeds will, they'll crack open and sprout in the morning. And then we have fans that kick on due to the heat that's in there, so if it gets hot enough inside the greenhouse, the fans kick on and kick off when it cools down. Then we have electric heaters in there that kick on if it gets too cold in the greenhouse. And so we have it all set up on clocks. We have a few greenhouses that we don't have that set up, but the main ones that we use to start the seeds and stuff like that are all set up for that.
What would have happened before those technologies were implemented?
It would have been difficult for people. So the seed would have taken twice as long to come up. You would have had to cover everything constantly with some kind of like blanket or something, which would have also suffocated the plant instead of using this new Rime cloth that they came out with, which allows the plant to still breathe but also keeps it from freezing. And knowing the temperature really helps. I mean, they've had thermostats for a long time, but they're still not accurate. Even if you look in the sky, sometimes you can judge if it's going to be freeze tonight, or like tonight it's going to freeze because it's clear out, but a huge storm could come in and we wouldn't know about it. So technology really has helped. It's nice to actually have a trade to teach my kids later down the road actually how to farm and stuff. Maybe they want to be farmers one day, who knows, but it's nice to have that extra trade to pass down to someone and know how to do more than the one thing, because stuff slowly dies out over the years and people forget how to do it.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. Do you think you'll take an active role in trying to preserve the property in your family as agriculture, or hold on to it?
Well, this is Wayne's place here, so it's all Wayne's property and stuff like that. We're just renting it momentarily. I might later on, like if my dad buys a place, and I might maintain it for him or something like that. Or if we get a farm stand on here to run full time, then I'll probably come and help maintain it at times. Uh-huh.
Will you choose a wife from an agricultural background, do you think?
Probably not. I might, but the one that I'm falling in love with right now, she's more of a historian than she is a farmer. But she does like that I am a rancher and a farmer, so I have all those stuff. But she does want to have a farm later on in life, so we might go and get a farm and have horses and stuff like that.
You think you'll stay here in the area?
I might move back east, just because she grew back up there and there's a lot of good colleges back there for her and me to go back there and learn, but we might come back out here eventually at some point, because Oregon's very nice for how green and every water all the time out here. Yeah.
What's the hardest part about doing what you're doing?
Mostly the hours. We wake up at, in the summer, well, not now. In the winter, we just get up anytime we want and come out here and work all day and then go home. But in the summer times, we get up, we get up at 6 o'clock in the morning, come out here when it's freezing cold, load everything up, go to work, stay there until about 3, then come home again, unload all everything, water everything, reharvest everything for the next day, and then vice versa, you do it over and over and over again.
That's hard work.
Yeah, it's fun, but yeah, it's hard work. When we first moved to this property, when we had to move, when my dad and I had to pack up and move over here, we had to rebuild all these greenhouses that you see here behind you. And that was probably almost a year and a half worth of stuff before we even had the last greenhouse up. And over the years, we've had issues. Like last year, the plastic got ripped off by a wind tornado, and that was a huge issue because 2 months before that, we just bought the plastic and we worked really hard and we got it all hooked on. But you learn a lot. Like I could build a greenhouse in my sleep now, basically, like that. So it's real easy to learn. You not only learn plants, but you learn weather and you learn building and you learn how to run machinery. Like a couple years ago when I was getting my driver's license and stuff like that, I already knew how to drive all kinds of machinery, quads and tractors and little lawn mowers and stuff like that. And shoot, my dad would let me drive the truck sometimes too, and it was great. So
if the zombies come, will you survive?
Yeah, probably, just because I know how to grow plants and stuff.
Will you say that for me?
What if the end of the world comes and just everything goes to, yeah, we'd probably come out here, get our generator, use all the greenhouses and grow food. Probably works really good too.
Oh, Grandpa, you're in the spotlight again.
No, the onions are not me. Maybe my hand.
Where does this come from, all the way from Texas?
Those onions?
Yeah, those onions come from Texas.
Heritage. Is that what we're from, Heritage? Yes. We have had a big heritage in our family. You know, many of us, when you have 9 children in the family, and I tell you, my grandmother was the greatest grandmother ever was, you know. And she always had Christmas. She lived right over here in a house. And she had to leave it up there, so she moved down here. And it was just wonderful, because all the family would come to Christmas dinner. And at that time, we were living in Ashland, and we drove all the way down here to Ashland and be here by 5 o'clock when breakfast started. And as each family came, she'd serve them, and then another family come, and the others just get out and talk and visit, all 9 of them. So that's really a big family. Yeah.
Can you talk about the agencies that have helped?
Well, as far as the future for me, it's probably when I'm done, I'm done. So as far as the future of agriculture, I mean, there's always gonna be someone to take my place out there, so I'm sure. But I mean, it is getting harder and harder with new laws that are coming into effect. We've got new water laws coming up. We've got new labor laws, you know, that could affect farming, GMOs, just a lot of things that out there that makes it harder to farm anymore. And prices just keep going up and up and up on things too. So, I mean, the best thing that's happened this year is fuel prices went down, you know. Hopefully it'll trickle down to everything else. Probably not, but it would be nice. I just heard last night on the news that they're no longer taking recyclable plastic because it costs more to recycle plastic than it's worth, so they're not taking recycled plastic anymore. So what do we do with our plastic when we get done? Well, I guess it goes to the landfill now. So it's just, you know, different things cycle back and around. So as far as sustainable, well, you know, as far as soil, we don't use any, you know, chemical fertilizers or harsh chemicals at all like that. If we do, we have to spray, we use organic methods. We're not a certified farm, but I mean, we probably could be if we wanted to. I just, you know, never gone that route. We grow a lot of cover crops, you know, to rebuild the soil, to work back in the soil, to keep the soil, you know, regenerated so we can keep, you know, farm it over and over like that, and rotating crops around, stuff like that. So we try the best we can to do that. I mean, it's hard in this day and age to make a living doing that way, you know, because it is expensive, especially organic products have really went sky high because everybody's got into organic farming. So organic fertilizers are just crazily priced. And so the only way you keep doing it is to pass that price on to the customer, which makes organic products go higher. I understand GMOs. Right. I mean, I don't personally, you know, believe in growing GMOs because I just don't think it's the way, especially for small farms, they, you know. And the reason that they've done GMOs is to help, you know, here comes our onions, Brandon. Sorry. you know, GMOs are to feed the world. I mean, we got a lot of people in this world. And to try to do it, like, say, with heirloom products, you're not going to do it. And that's why they've had to, you know, go with GMOs. So I'm not totally against GMOs as far as that goes, but I would never do it. We have a hard time with minimum wage because the only thing it's going to do is cause everything else to go higher, because that's the only way people can stay in business, because we grow a lot of green beans and they're all hand-picked. Right now we're selling beans for, you know, $2 to $3 a pound. Well, if you bump that up, we're going to have to start selling for $4, $5, $6 a pound, you know, just to pass it on. And it's hard to compete with the big guys that are using machines to harvest the green beans, even though our product's fresher, you know, maybe organic or not. Still, you're still competing those two different prices, so it makes it hard for a small farm to with higher wages. Sustainable, something that you put the time in, like rebuilding your soil, making the soil so it's not going to wear out, so it's going to last for generations to come. You know, so you don't want to use a lot of harsh chemicals on your soils to keep. You want to keep the soil alive, so it's going to continue to replenish the earth. So. Stewardship, I mean, that's kind of the same. I mean, taking care of the property, you know, being a good steward, you know, good management of your property. Heritage, kind of a traditional kind of, you know, continuation of growing. Heritage vegetables, ones that will kind of hand on down so the next generation can keep growing the same things, unlike the GMOs.
Sustainable, like keeping the stuff in the family and trying to keep future farmers to keep farming so there's food for the whole world to survive. Basically making it so even though that a lot of people are being replaced by machines nowadays, that it should still have people doing the actual work and farming for themselves so they know how to farm later on even if something goes horribly wrong.
Does sustainable include to you the concepts of finance, lifestyle balance?
Yeah. So a lot of what farming is for my dad and for us as a family, it's a very hard living to make financing stuff like that, because during the winter months you have nothing really to grow because nothing grows unless you have greenhouses. But over the summer, that's your main point of time where you make all your money. And over the years, it's been getting harder and harder to make money because everything rises, and because that stuff rises, it makes it harder to transport stuff to market because of gas prices and stuff like that. So as the years go over, the prices get higher and higher, and you eventually have to make your plants higher because you have to make the money in order to pay for the gas to move the plants to where you're going to sell them and stuff like that. But so far it's been working out over the years. We have been making greater progress, like we've opened this farm stand and it's really made a lot more money for us, and we've upgraded greenhouses, and so it's more of like a 50-50 chance. One year the weather could be horrible and you could lose a whole crop, or the next year you could get really good crops and make a load of money off that because you have so much harvest. But that's how it works basically.
What about the word stewardship?
Stewardship? What is stewardship? I'm drawing a blank.
How about heritage?
Heritage, over the years, my family have been doing quite a job. Like from my grandpa, I learned this last year. It was quite cool. So I think 1839 is when his grandfather went into Medford and set up a little booth there and gave away vegetables for free just because he had extra ones there. And that was pretty impressive to find out and to know that we're still farming to this day and age. And we're still selling stuff to people and taking it to market, and that's quite impressive to me. Yeah.
So talk about the future of agriculture.
The future of agriculture, I really like how everything's going. I'm more of those modern kids where it's like I would have a tractor that would be electronical, just plow the fields for you basically, instead of actually be out there and ride on it all day. But I really like where they're going. I think they should lower the price of all this future tech that they want for farming, because in order for it to, for us lower guys to afford it to actually use on the property, would be great. But no, I love all the future stuff where you have automatic sprinklers and hydroponic, and I mean there are some downsides to it, like all this GMO and all this these hybrid seeds and all that stuff. I mean, it was made for a reason, but people took advantage of it because it's money. And but other than that, I really like all the how everything gets better and over the years and stuff like that.
Well, I mean, one thing nice about, you know, farmers markets versus stores is we harvest everything the night before or the day before, and it goes that morning. So, I mean, it's as fresh as you can get. I mean, I sell to other stores too, but they'll stick it in the coolers, and it may stay in the cooler for 2 days before they put it on the shelf because they're rotating crops. Where ours is, you know, direct from the farm, you know, to that person. They might go home and have it for lunch, and it's not even 24 hours old. And it's just almost impossible to do that when you got a grocery store or something like that. I mean, it's even fresher sometimes at the market is the farm stand. Sometimes the farm stand's older than it is at the market. So if you want fresh, go to the farmer's market. You're not going to get any fresher. Had to put my plug in there.